Good morning, everybody. Welcome to church this morning. It's great to see you. You don't see this, but every Sunday morning I have the privilege of being able to see behind you out into the garden as the children are gathering and running around. And I think I saw Spider-Man then just running past. It's wonderful. We have the families, children, and everyone with us as well. Welcome also to those of you who are joining us online. It's great to have this opportunity to be able to worship God together, our good God who is with us, who loves us, who will never ever leave us or let us down. As we begin, I'd like to lead us in prayer. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your goodness to us. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity this morning that we have to gather as your people to worship you. Lord, thank you for your word, which we will look at later in the service. Thank you that your word is rich and alive, inspired by your Spirit. Continue to ask God that you would speak to us through your word to mold and shape us into the people you've created us to be. Lord, as we worship you, would you make us aware of your presence with us through your Spirit? Would we hear you and sense you and know you moving and working in our presence? Lord, we ask that you would have this your way with this time together. We're here for you. This is your church. Continue to grow us, Lord, to become more like Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we invite you to stand and we'll sing some worship songs together, beginning with 10,000 Reasons. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Yeah. been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so
to have a seat. Who knows something of the goodness of God in their life? Just give me a little wave. Let me know you're awake. God is good, isn't he? He is with us. He loves us. And he blesses us. I'm going to bless you now with some notices. Isn't that wonderful? A few things to let you know about in the life of our church. First of all, if you're a church member, then there is a church members meeting after the morning service next week. So come along ready to take part if you're a church member. There's important things on the agenda about some plans for September in terms of Sundays and also things happening with the cafe and other things as well. So please do prioritise that if you're able next Sunday after the morning service. Also, want to confirm for you, many of you will be aware already, the arrangements for Olive Heisler's funeral, Monday the 17th of this month, so it's not tomorrow, but a week tomorrow, Olive's funeral is taking place. Everyone is welcome to come along. There'll be a committal service at Croydon Crematorium from 10:45 a.m. for close family and friends, and then a lunch after that, and then a service here at 2 p.m. in the church, a service of thanksgiving for Olive's long and full life. It won't be possible to tell the whole story because she lived a very full life for a long time, but we want to give thanks to God for her life, for who she was, for the memories she leaves, for the friendships we built with her, and for her testimony to who God was, for her living faith in Jesus as her Saviour, which gives us hope that even in our sadness that she's no longer with us, she is now with her Saviour, free from all pain and sickness and ailment, and living her best life. I'd like to lead us in some prayers now. I'm going to pray for Olive's family and close friends, and also for other people and situations. Let's come before God in prayer. Father God, we thank you for who you are, a good and upright God, faithful and just. God who is all-powerful, a big God, who holds us in your hand. Lord, thank you that as we come to you in prayer, we know that you hear our prayers, and you choose to use our prayers to effect change in your world. So, Lord, we come and we pray in faith. We pray in Jesus' name, confident that you hear and you answer in perfect ways. Father, we do want to lift before you Olive's family and friends, those who are missing her most. May they know you in their grief and pain. Lord, we pray for all the final arrangements for the funeral, that everything would fall into place well. Pray for Mike and Nikki, particularly, who are organising a lot of things, not just for the funeral, but in all the other admin stuff that needs to be taken care of. Pray that you'd be close to them and they would know your presence and your help. Father, we pray for others who are grieving the loss of loved ones at this time. Lord, may they know your comfort and your help, your strength in those difficult days. Father, we pray for others who maybe aren't able to move around as freely as they would want to, perhaps those who are at home or in care homes. Lord, we pray that they too would know your presence and your strength. Pray particularly for Janet Hale. We pray that her house sale would go through without complication, that the right people would be found to buy the property for a right and fair price, and that there would be no unnecessary complications or delays. We pray for Doris Sawyer as well, Lord. We pray that she would know your presence with her. Pray particularly for her hand, which she damaged just recently, caught it in a window. Just pray you'd bring your healing there. Father, we pray too for others who particularly need your help at this time. Lord, we pray for Rebecca, Vanessa Edwards' daughter. Lord, we pray that you would be with especially the medical professionals who are caring for her. Lord, thank you that the pain in her head was eased this past week through lumbar puncture. Lord, we pray that that wouldn't be necessary again, but solutions would be found to bring Rebecca the help that she needs. We pray that you'd help her to grow stronger each day, and pray for her husband and her son and for the wider family. Lord, may they know your strength. We pray for healing for Rebecca in Jesus' name. Father, we continue to pray for Sandra Mottishead and particularly for her sister. Pray that you would be at work in that situation. And again, we ask for healing in Jesus' name. Lord, for others who particularly need your help at this time, we lift these folk to you in the silence of our hearts and minds now. Thank you, God, that you know and love every single one of us. You know and love every person that we have lifted to you in the quiet. Thank you that you are with them. May they know and experience your faithful presence and your help and strength. Lord, we thank you too for the children and young people who are connected with your church here. Lord, thank you for their lives, for the people you are growing them to become. Lord, we ask that you would be with those even now who are caring for them, showing them your love and connecting with them the truths of your word. Lord, we pray that they would grow to know and love you as Lord and Savior. Thank you for the families that they come from. We pray for your blessing upon them. Lord, we know that you are God of the whole world. So we pray for those places where there is unrest, conflict, and war. Lord Jesus, would you please bring your peace? We pray for those areas where there is suffering, perhaps through natural disasters, through unequal distribution of resources. Lord, we pray that you would meet the needs of those who are most vulnerable. And Lord, we pray for your church across the world. We pray for those Christians who live in fear because the way that the places they live would cause them problems because of their faith and the outworking of their belief in you. Lord, we pray for those who are persecuted Christians, that you would give them strength, that you would sustain their faith, and that you would give them blessings when they're able to look at your word, when they're able to meet with others who are Christians too. Would you encourage them and bless them? Thank you for the inspiration they are to us. Lord, help us not ever to take for granted the freedom which we have to come and worship you. Lord, we pray that your church would continue to grow. Thank you. And you promise that you will build your church. Grow your church, Lord. Build your kingdom. And Lord, we pray for this church here. Lord, come and fill us with your Holy Spirit. As we continue in worship, as we look at your word, have your way with us, speak to us through your Spirit. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll continue in sung worship. I invite you to stand again as we sing When the Music Fades.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's on fire, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you
Please do have a seat.
So we continue this week with our series Growing on the Frontline, and using that term frontline to refer to the places where we spend our everyday lives, recognizing that every day throughout the week, not just on Sundays, God wants us to grow, to become more like Jesus, to live for him, to make a difference for him, to see him changing us and through us changing the world around us. All about becoming more like Jesus. So far we've thought about growing wherever we are, recognizing that God places us in specific situations and specific relationships for a reason, so that we can show other people who he is, so that we can live for him, so we can share his love and the good news of Jesus with those around us. There's always more room for growth, isn't there? There is. And then secondly, we looked at how our choices affect our fruitfulness. All the choices that we make have consequences. We looked at the story of Adam and Eve, and the choice that they made had far-reaching consequences. We have many choices to make throughout our lives, and we want to make good choices with healthy consequences so that we can grow, so that God's will can be done on our front lines. And we thought about how our desires affect our choices, influence our choices. We talked about the story of the Good Samaritan and looked at the desires, the inward stuff that was going on in the characters of the story of the Good Samaritan that led them to make the choices that they made. And then we looked at how our emotions reveal our desires. We looked at the temptation of Jesus, and we thought about some of the universal desires that we share, desires for approval, for security, for control, and how God can fulfill those desires. We can find those desires met first and foremost in him rather than looking in other places. And we thought about how we can mature in every season, recognizing that just as a tree goes through different stages of life and different seasons through the year, so we, as Christians, go through different stages in our walk with God and different seasons. How can we continue to grow and mature through every season? And then last time, the week before last, we looked at going deeper with God through tough times, thinking particularly about the winter seasons in our lives when things are difficult, how God is always with us, how God can help us through those times and grow us even in those tough times. In fact, sometimes even more through the difficulties than through the good times, if we will keep trusting in him. He will give us the resources to make it through. And so this week, we're going to think about turning inner growth into fruitful action. We'll be looking at James 3, verses 13 to 18. So far in this series, we thought a lot about what's going on inside, about our feelings and our desires. And this week, we're going to consider how we can use this increased self-awareness to help us to really make a difference for God on our front lines. If our choices stem from our unchecked desires, rather than from our roots firmly planted in God and his word, then we can be like the person that James describes earlier on in his letter in James 1. Person who listens to the word of God but does not do what it says. Someone who looks at their face in the mirror, says James, and then immediately goes away and forgets what they look like. If you're like me, you might think that's a blessing, but that's not the point that James is making. In other words, after reflecting, receiving, and renewing, we need to make sure that we don't go away and forget what we've learned. We don't go away and not put it into practice. We want to that process of self-reflection and allowing God to reveal things about ourselves to influence us, not just in the abstract, not just as some theoretical exercise, but in real life, in our everyday, in the detail of life on our front lines. A number of years ago, I was leading a youth work session after church on a Sunday evening, and I received... After the session had finished, the young people had left and got home, I received a phone call from an irate parent. And they were very concerned because their young person had not arrived home as they were expecting. And what they assumed was it's because Phil was still babbling on. Can you imagine? Can you imagine someone thinking that? that Phil would be going on and on and on and on. No, I can tell you can't imagine that whatsoever. So they phoned me up absolutely irate because their young person had an exam the following day. And so they were giving me rather a tirade of abuse on the phone because of their love and concern and care for their young person who they knew needed to be home and in bed so they'd be at their most awake for their exam the following day. As I listened to the words that were being said to me, I was faced with a choice about how to respond. And it just so happens that in that very session that I'd been leading with the young people that evening, we'd been looking at some of the words from James chapter 1, which say, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires." And I look back now and I see how God deliberately made sure that we were looking at those verses on that evening. Because if I hadn't had that freshly in my mind, I would have responded in a very different way. Had a choice to make in that moment. And we all have choices to make all the time, don't we, in our everyday lives. Situations happen where there are ways that we can respond, different ways that we can respond. We can respond with anger. We can meet anger with anger. I could have chosen to shout louder than the person who was shouting at me. I could have been defensive, matching the tone of the parent. But that wouldn't have helped, would it? I could have responded with anxiety and become very defensive. I could have sought to be a people pleaser in that moment, feeling insecure and unnecessarily perhaps apologizing. Maybe even going as far as to avoid that person in the future. I had a choice. But because those words were in my head, I decided to be slow to speak. Now, I'm not trying to big myself up. There have been many other occasions when God didn't give me that verse a few hours before the situation, and I've responded differently. But on that occasion, I was slow to speak. Eventually, the parent on the phone kind of wound down in their anger, and we were able to try and work through the situation. I was able to say, well, the session ended a while ago. I don't know where your young person is, but hey, I know, you know, the route that they would have taken to get home. I'm going to go out in the car and have a look and see if I can find them. And if, in the end, the young person turned up. I don't think they made the same mistake again. Let's put it that way. But I had a choice in that moment, didn't I? We all have choices. We can follow the Spirit's lead. Remembering those words of James 1 and other parts of God's word. And these situations come up so frequently in our lives, perhaps sometimes we can even miss them altogether. All the more reason, therefore, to try and be prepared, to try and ready ourselves that we can respond well when those opportunities arise. How we deal with our unchecked desires in moments like those makes all the difference, doesn't it? So let's look at James 3, verses 13 to 18 to see the words that are written there. Words should be on the screen for you. "Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come from down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice." The button's not working. Thanks, Callum. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. So here James is describing two different types of wisdom. Godly wisdom, which leads to a fruitful life, and earthly wisdom, which is unspiritual, even demonic, James describes. It leads to selfish or self-serving ways of life. Maybe this reminds us of the bush and the tree that we looked at in Jeremiah 17 earlier on in this series. The healthy tree which was planted by the stream with roots that go deep down and gather up the rich nutrients from the soil and the water that needs for life, bearing good fruit with healthy limbs and leaves. And the other bush planted in the barren place, bearing no fruit, withering, never growing to its full potential. This is a way of describing the battle that goes on within all of us when we're faced with these choices of this two kinds of wisdom, godly wisdom or ungodly wisdom. When our unchecked desires get out of hand, we might not feel like this godly wisdom is in our best interest at all. It's natural, isn't it, when someone attacks us to want to be defensive, to stand up for ourselves, to put the record straight. And it is right that there should be justice in God's world, that we shouldn't be unfairly treated, but the way that we go about responding makes all the difference, doesn't it, in those situations. We spoke earlier on in a series about these universal desires that we all have, desires for security, that we would be safe and protected and standing on our own two feet, self-sufficient. Desire for approval, to be loved and accepted and needed in the world. Desire for a measure of control, that we'd be masters of our own destiny, free to make our own choices. When we look in the mirror, I wonder which one of those we see most clearly in our lives. Which one of those is the most real struggle for us? And as we think about the two types of person described in that passage in James 3, who would we rather be? Bitter, selfish, envious, or humble, wise, peace-loving, pure, considerate, sincere, full of mercy and good fruit? It's a no-brainer, isn't it? So how can we practice being alert to God's wisdom in every situation? Even or especially when unchecked desires want our attention. What can we do to ensure that we have the ability to respond fruitfully on our front lines, especially when we come under pressure? Well, some of it is like the old song that I remember singing in Sunday school. Read your Bible, pray every day if you want to grow. So simple, but so profound and so wise. Read your Bible, pray every day if you want to grow. Letting God into the nooks and crannies in our lives, of the inside stuff, you know, the stuff that people don't see always. Asking him to help us day by day, to make us more like Jesus. Recognizing that we're not perfect. Being honest with God about our weaknesses and our shortcomings. Handing our lives over to God day by day. Saying, God, my life today is yours. Take and use it as you want. Help me to be led by you, guided by you, inspired by you, empowered by you. We need to pause, to press the pause button. Maybe we need to send short arrow prayers in to God in the moment. And we can use something actually called the pause prayer. It's an acronym they call that, don't they? Where the letter of the word pause stands for something. P is for pause, funny enough. It can be really hard, can't it, when we're faced with a situation, like that angry parent on the phone. Honestly, if we hadn't had that passage earlier on that evening, I'm sure I wouldn't have responded in that way. But God helped me in that moment to just pause, just to wait. Didn't need to respond. Didn't need to defend myself. Didn't need to say, no, you're completely wrong. The session finished an hour ago. Your young person is a right little so-and-so. That wouldn't have helped, would it? Pause. Long enough to notice as well how we're feeling. To reflect on ourselves, not just about the other person in the situation, but think about how is this affecting me and what does that tell me about myself? Paying attention to what's happening here so that I can allow God into that and help me to respond. Second, acknowledge. So be honest about our feelings. When that parent on the phone started shouting, I was defensive. It's not my fault. You raised the no. That wouldn't be helpful, would it? Acknowledge, where does that come from? So I want to be accepted because I want people to approve of me because I don't want to do stuff that makes people angry or upset. Resisting the urges to justify or to judge. U is for understand. Consider what our feelings reveal for us about the unchecked desires. And some of this can happen in the moment. Some of it perhaps happens when we reflect afterwards. There's quite a lot here to try and think we can do that in a few seconds, maybe. But pausing, definitely, we can manage. Consider what our feelings reveal for us about our unchecked desires. Remember that fear often links to the desire for safety or security. Shame often links to a desire for approval. Anger often links to a desire for a measure of control. Understanding what's going on, recognizing, learning about ourselves. S is for surrender. If we recognize that one of those unchecked desires, which is driving us in that moment, we can invite Jesus into that. Say, look, I'm weak in this area. I know I am. I want people to love and accept me. Help me to know, God, that you love and accept me, and that's all that really matters. May I get confidence from that to enable me to respond healthily in those moments. Lord, I understand. I want to control the situation. So my anger now is because I'm not in control right now. God, would you give me your peace and help me? Etc., etc. And then engage. E is for engage. Prayerfully place ourselves and the outcome in God's hands. To say, I don't need to defend myself necessarily. God, I trust you that you will fight my battles. Ask for God's wisdom to be able to respond well the next time we face a situation like that or in that moment. So pause. Pause, acknowledge, understand, surrender, and engaged. It was so helpful in that moment on the phone with that parent for me just to shut my mouth. But I find that very difficult. Do you? I find it helpful to remember that God created me with two ears and one mouth. Listen twice as much as I speak. Just that. I mean, if we all were to practice that this week, I wonder what difference we would find in our lives. Big difference, maybe. Big difference. The reality is that we have opportunities all the time coming our way, but we need God's help to be able to respond well in a healthy way, to make healthy decisions which lead to fruitfulness on our front lines. So let's pray and ask God for that help right now. Father God, we thank you for your word. Thank you for those verses in James that we've been thinking about briefly. Lord, help us to be people who are wise, people who have godly wisdom. Father, we pray for this week ahead. No doubt there will be situations where we have opportunities to press pause, to invite you in, to reflect upon ourselves, to ask for your help that we may respond in a healthy way. God, thank you that you can take and use ordinary people like us and these ordinary situations to draw people closer to yourself, to show people who you are, to reveal your love, to bring people to faith in Jesus. So, Lord, we offer ourselves, Lord, with warts and all, in the reality of who we are and the struggles that we face day by day. We say, God, we're not perfect, but thank you that you are with us and you can help us. Have your way with us, God. Fill us with your Spirit. Help us to pause and to respond well, we ask. In Jesus' name. Amen. Our service is drawing to a close, our time together in here. We welcome you to stick around for refreshments afterwards if you're able. And we're going to stand again and sing, God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. I will love you, Lord, my strength. Let's stand.
I look to you.
our God reigns. Hallelujah. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. God bless you.